guys can come on in. Yeah. Just kind of fall around the sides here. Good morning. Welcome to St. John the Baptist Catholic Church. We invite you to stand and face the back of the church here near the baptistry as we begin. Today we gather together to show our love to a woman who showed us love in this world, and we show her our love today through our presence and our prayers. And we pray together in the sign of victory over death, the sign of the cross. We pray together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, June died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May she now share with him eternal glory. Amen. Bill, do you want to hand me the aspergillum? Thank you. Now we place the pall over the casket, which represents the baptismal grace that she received, the grace that allows her to enter into heaven. I invite you to follow along as well in the leaflet that has our music and readings. I invite you to be seated. I invite John Ford now to say a few words on behalf of the family.
June Kroening had amazing powers to mobilize a community. When June saw a need or had an idea for brightening people's spirits, she'd sit down and make telephone call after telephone call to enlist a big crew of helpers, and then she'd carry the project out. For years, I've said that June was the purest extrovert that I've ever known. Extroverts take energy from interacting with other people, and June could make 30 telephone calls and rise up refreshed and energized by the experience, where most of us would be exhausted. But June's daughter, Anne, tells me that June really wasn't an extrovert. She valued solitude, and she liked to be alone. All those telephone calls were driven by her service ethic and her tenacious character. If June was told that something wasn't possible, it made her more determined to see it through. I speak today for all of us in honoring June. But in a special way, I'm speaking for St. Lawrence Parish in Dinkytown, where June was the leading spirit for decades. Many of you are St. Lawrence alumni, and you know the great work that June did there. June organized scores of events in the St. Lawrence Social Hall, mobilizing helpers and often doing most of the cooking. There were funeral luncheons, and there were final exam meals for college students. There were the complex logistics of the Christmas Bazaar, where June sold tickets and set up tables and cooked her legendary chili and vigorously sold gifts in the booth that she called Granny's Attic. June also created a German fest. She brought in a German band and cooked up masses of sausages, and she decorated the dingy St. Lawrence Social Hall in Bavarian decor. Many of you can picture that dingy social hall. It looked like you'd imagine a mess hall at the state prison. There were gray cinder block walls and gray concrete pillars and dreary linoleum tile underfoot and acoustical tile on the ceiling. June famously had an inspiration to enliven the place by hanging hundreds of snowflakes from the ceiling to set the mood for the Christmas bazaar. June somehow scrounged up about 20 pairs of scissors. I imagine that she probably went door to door. She made her telephone calls, and she cooked 5 pans of lasagna, and she assembled a big crew of young adults to cut snowflakes in her living room. June inserted those snowflakes in the pages of old Life magazines to keep them crisp. And then in early December, she gathered a lot of stepladders, and she sent us up to hang about 500 snowflakes all over the social hall. It was transformational, and it was an amazing display of her creativity and her powers of organization. I could go on about June's community projects, but her most important work was outreach and hospitality and motherly mentoring of young people. St. Lawrence had a distinctive mix of parishioners. There were hundreds of young adults, most of whom were students or very recent alumni from the University of Minnesota. But the territorial parish in southeast Minneapolis was solidly blue collar. It was a serendipitous mix. The students enlivened the blue collar parish, and the blue collar parish steadied the students. June embodied that steadying influence with her small town values and her amazing hospitality. She constantly looked out for new people on the margins of the community. She'd introduce herself, and often she'd invite them home for a meal. There were always extra plates at the Kroening table. In the past days, we've been exchanging stories of June's hospitality. She made birthday cakes for people she didn't know, She always invited the priests to come over on holidays. When Frank and Julie Strawn got married, Frank's mother was ill, and June stepped up to cook the groom's dinner for 30 people in her kitchen at home. The Kroening household also served as an occasional overnight refuge for young men who sometimes drank more than was good for them. That refuge entailed hearing the talk, June's pointed motherly advice. Here's a reflection, slightly edited, from one of those formerly young men. He says, "The story we tell after all these years is of June's sermon the morning after one of those rampages. She said, 'You know, you won't be able to keep living under this lucky star forever.' We call it the lucky star sermon." June was right, of course. Had we continued that lifestyle, we'd be dead or worse by now. "It occurs to me," he continues, "that June was playing a long game with us, sensing an opportunity to guide and teach, even if it didn't take hold right away. She was planting a seed of civilized behavior and perspective in us. Seeing how that group of young men has flourished in their maturity as husbands and fathers, I can attest that this was so." I want to tell a last June Kroening story. June counseled firmly against drunkenness, but she had no problem with drinking beer in moderation. When their oldest son, Joe, came of age, June and Martin allowed him to host a birthday party with an 8-gallon keg. Now, attendance at the party was light, and there was a lot of beer left over. So June pumped the excess beer into pitchers, and she took them across the street and offered them to the rowdy students living in a rental property there. The students were taken aback, and they weren't eager to take the beer. They probably thought that it was a sting operation. And that June was an agent of the police. But the story exemplifies June's practicality and her outgoing nature. June's daughter Anne says that she was mom in the moment for everyone. That phrase sums her life up beautifully. We give thanks to God for June's friendship, her leadership, and her amazingly generous example.
Thank you for your words. Together, let's stand and continue now with our prayers. Let us pray. O God, who through the ending of present things open up the beginning of things to come, grant, we pray, for the soul of your servant June, may she be led by you to attain the inheritance of eternal redemption. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. I invite you to be seated now as we listen to the readings from the sacred scriptures.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. There is an appointed time for everything, and a time for every affair under the heavens, a time to give birth and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot the plant, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to be far from embraces, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. What profit have workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to mortals to be busied about. God has made everything appropriate to its time, but has put the timeless into their hearts, so they cannot find out from beginning to end the work which God has done. I recognize that there is nothing better than to rejoice and do well during life. Moreover, that all can eat and drink and enjoy the good of all their toil. This is a gift of God. I recognized that whatever God does will endure forever. There is no adding to it or taking from it. Thus has God done that he may be revered. What now is has already been. What is to be already is. God retrieves what has gone by. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingly power, proclaim the word. Be persistent, whether it is convenient or inconvenient. Convince, reprimand, encourage through all patience and teaching. For I am already being poured out like a libation, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have competed well. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel of Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain. And after he had sat down, his disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My name is Father Paul Jarvis, and
I serve in Minneapolis, in the north side of Minneapolis, and it's a privilege and a pleasure, I believe, to be able to break open this word. But before I do, I need to mention how something unusual happened on the way to the celebration of life of June. I was heading in the door, and there was a younger person. Now, I'm 66, so anybody below the age of 50 is young to me. But after, we didn't have much time because I needed to get prepared. And so towards the end of our brief conversation, I went this gesture. And the young person, seeing this gesture, said, "I love you too." Now, I know that this is a sign for "I love you" in sign language, and I know it's also a football gesture, but people my age, and June's age, and Martin's age, and I think a number of people's ages here would know this means, give me a call. Give me a phone call. Now, this is going to be new to some of the younger folks out there, but believe it or not, when June was growing up, and also this includes my generation, when we were growing up, we had this thing called a telephone. And it had kind of like it was shaped like this, that you would actually put to your mouth and to your ear. You would talk into the speaker, and it was connected by a cord to this thing called a telephone, and it was a box-like thing. And to call someone, you didn't just press somebody's name on a cell phone. In fact, you didn't do any pressing at all. You would do this thing called dialing. And you would go like this with the Father Chauvelin. This is new to you, too. You would actually put your finger in one of the holes of this dial, and you would go, you didn't make that sound, it would make it for you. And you would do that several times. In fact, you would do it, well, depending on your town, if it was in Verndale, it was probably just a few of those numbers. But in Minneapolis, we might have even had something like 5 or 6 numbers, right? But you would dial, and it would take some time. And you would use that time, I think, June used this time, to think about what she wanted to say to the person. Not only the words that she would say, but the feeling that she would convey through this phone, through this telephone. Again, I don't have to tell you today, you know, you just beep, bop, boop, and then you're connected. But back in the day when you would dial up somebody and you were calling somebody, you are very aware that you were being charged by Ma Bell the longer you're on this phone call. So you had to think about what you were going to say. And you had to think about what you wanted to convey. And there's not a person here who does not know that the essence of every phone call, almost every phone call, the essence of every phone call June ever made would be a message of love, of care. Now, we heard in the Beatitudes in this gospel today words that sometimes go in one ear and out the other. We say it so often, maybe pray it, hopefully. But you'll notice that key to these Beatitudes, key to these blessings, is not only a humble spirit, not only a humility, not only a meekness that is actually strength. But running throughout these Beatitudes is love. Love that is actually caring about in our mind and our hearts, but even more importantly, brothers and sisters, a caring for, and if possible, assisting. And that's the kind of love, that's the kind of beatitude that June embodied throughout her life. Well, to be honest, I don't know what she was like as a girl in Verndale. You know, maybe when she was on the party line, she listened in on other people's phone calls, but I highly doubt it. I highly doubt it. Because for the vast, vast majority of her life, she believed in living out the teachings of love, that love incarnate, demonstrated on the cross, and also taught again and again and again and again, to care about and to actively care for. I think there's a story that needs to be told in addition to that beautiful eulogy that was given by John before our Mass. There's an anecdote, a real story of somebody getting on that phone. This is, again, pre-beep-bop-bop-bop days. And accidentally calling June. They had entitled, you know, when you dialed in the old rotary phones or maybe even in the push-button phones, you would sometimes get the wrong number. But they did not get the wrong number when they accidentally called June. This person, who's probably here, I don't know, didn't get that person's permission to say his name. But he was in his 20s and he was not feeling good about life, about his life. So he was phoning somebody and he accidentally got the wrong number, which turned out to be the right number, which turned out to be June's number. And somehow June could tell, because she was living the life of the Beatitudes, in her mercy, in her care, she was able to tell that this person was troubled. And instead of just saying, "You've got the wrong number," there I go again, I'm going like that. She stayed on the phone with him and talked with him. She showed him mercy. Her clean heart showed that she cared for this child of God on the phone with her. And she would be that witness to love, that example of love, that would be just what he needed to hear in that moment. And somehow in there, and those of you who are part of the St. Lawrence youth group will recognize this as June, as the mother to all, she somehow fit in there an invitation to come and check out the young adult group at St. Lawrence, the young adult volleyball group at St. Lawrence. He would join it, and there he would find not only many friends, many caring friends living out the Beatitudes, but he would find somebody who would be his soulmate. June connected them through the young adult group, connected them, and because of that listening, that caring heart, that pure heart, that clean heart that listened to him and could hear his voice, hear the trouble in his voice, she would be, at least this gentleman says, responsible for them getting married and eventually having children. And so if it wasn't for June, maybe none of this would have happened. The telephone is really an extension of our voice, which hopefully, if we're living the Beatitude life, is an extension of love, extension of care, of mercy. Today we remember somebody who practiced this kind of care and concern, not only on the phone, that she did that quite often as a church lady at St. Lawrence, right? But she practiced that care and concern in person. She lived out the life of Beatitude in person with a great many people. And I have no doubt that June would have advice in addition to the advice she gave, according to John's incredible eulogy, she would encourage each and every one of us to stay connected or be the connection for other people that they need, that God sends your way. So I know you all have access to a phone. And I think June would encourage you to use that phone. Maybe even going through, nowadays we just go through contacts on the phone. Wasn't so easy back in the day. And find someone you haven't talked with for a while. Or maybe you think you've visited with them in the last year, but it's probably been more like 10 or 15 years. And think of June. Think of what June's teacher, our rabbi, our savior taught us to do, and give them a call, if only to say, I was just thinking of you. And then listen. Listen to the tenor of their voice. Listen to see if there's anything that you can do with a clean heart, what you can do to help them. As we used to say, or we used to hear all the time on TV, let your fingers do the walking through your contacts on your cell phone.
Together, let's stand and continue now with our prayers, bringing our petitions before the Lord.
In baptism, June received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead her over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy, many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await the kingdom of heaven. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy, the family and friends of June seek comfort and consolation. Hear their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that comes from grief. Lord, in your mercy. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy. We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our sister, June. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we bring before you these prayers this day. We ask you to hear and answer them, for make them in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, who is Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
I invite you to be seated now as the gifts are brought forward and the altar is prepared. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, so that your departed servant June may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that in your sight we might all live forever. And so in the company of the choirs of angels we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. I invite you to kneel or be seated as you are able now for the Eucharistic prayer. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." A mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Bernard, our Archbishop, Michael, and Joseph, our auxiliary bishops, and all the clergy.
Remember your servant June, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who is united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. That with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, St. John the Baptist, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, God forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. I invite you to kneel or be seated now as you are able for the Eucharistic, for the rite of Holy Communion. For Holy Communion today, we welcome you to come forward by way of the center aisle, pass by the front of your pew, and return to your pews by way of the side aisles. We also do have a low-gluten option available. If you need low-gluten, please just let us know in the center aisle here, and we'll distribute a low-gluten host to you. All God's children are welcome to the sacred space and Holy Liturgy. The Catholic understanding of Holy Communion is that this is the true body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ. And by receiving Holy Communion, it shows you believe what the Catholic Church teaches. For those of you who are not Catholic, we sincerely welcome you here today. During communion, though, we ask you to receive a blessing. Please indicate this by crossing your arms over your shoulders like so. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that your servant June, for whom we have celebrated this Paschal sacrament, may pass over to a dwelling place of light and peace through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And on behalf of Father Joseph, my assistant, myself, Father Paul Shevlin, and all of us here at St. John the Baptist, we express our condolences and sympathies to your family. Be assured of our prayers with you and for you through this time. Also grateful to welcome Father Paul Jarvis as well as Father Tom Wilson to pray with us today. Following the conclusion of our liturgy today, everyone is welcome to our social hall for our luncheon, and then following the luncheon will be the burial at Hillside. Brothers and sisters, before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her, may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Saints of God, come to her aid. Hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most
High. As the incense rises, it reminds us of our prayers going with her to God, and we trust her to our Blessed Mother as well in heaven, asking Mary's intercession for her as we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister June in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon June in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In peace, let us take our sister to her place of rest. Speak to God.
In paradisum, dedo cante angeli, in tuo adventu, suscipiante marti. Jerusalem. glory.